Hi guys, it's Scott here, and in this second detailed drawing video, we're going to take a look at how to dimension and indicate welds, machining, and surface textures in your detailed drawings. Let's start by taking a look at how you go about dimensioning welds. This is covered in Chapter 15 of your Engineering Drawing Handbook. In this example shown, we have an object that is formed from three separate pieces of steel. We have this top section, a bottom plate, and another plate that is joined by a weld onto the side. When we come to draw this in a detail drawing, we don't draw each of these parts separately in a detail and then show them how to be welded together in a separate drawing. We put them all together and then we're going to indicate where the welds are and how big they are onto that drawing. So as you can see here, they're still shown as three separate pieces that are just butted up together so that we can indicate welds where it is appropriate. So the first weld that we're going to look at here is this fillet weld, a triangular shaped weld that is placed into this corner. This one's at 90 degrees, they can be at other angles, but this is most common. And for the sake of this example, let's say that this is 60 millimeters in length, this piece of steel. So how would we go about indicating this particular fillet weld? So here is one way to do it, and we're going to show you a few options. So we have our arrow on our leader pointing into where the weld is occurring in the intersection between these two plates here. Then we have the line coming across, and we put our weld dimension of 8 millimeters underneath this leader arrow, and we have a symbol for a fillet, which is this triangle underneath here as well. The dimension goes in front of the weld symbol in this case. That's the first way, and because our dimension is underneath and our triangle is underneath the line, that means that this weld is to be done where we're pointing, so in this exact corner where we're pointing. Another way to do it would be to point at the other side and to put the number and the triangle on the top of the line. This means that you should weld on the other side of where I'm pointing. So this can be a little bit confusing. So wherever possible, try to point to the actual place where the weld should be and go underneath the line. And only if you can't get clear access to it on your drawing should you use this other form where we put the number on and the triangle on the top of the line, and then point to the opposite face, the opposite corner to where the weld should be. We can also do it in this view here. So once again, this symbology means that we should do the weld over here or over here on this view. So they essentially mean the same thing, and to ensure that we don't over-dimension our drawing, we would only use one of these options in this case. There's a fourth version of it. So what would happen if we also needed to indicate a weld on this side of this plate as well? So now we've got a weld on both sides. How do we go about doing that? The easiest way to do it is to simply to add the 8 and the triangle to the bottom side of this arrow and leader. So this basically means, the bottom one means weld on this side, and the top one means weld on the opposite side as well. So we could do that on all of these, and all of them would mean the same thing and would be adequate to define the welds on both sides of this plate. What happens if we don't have the weld over the full length of this edge? So currently, if we specify the welds as we've got here, it means weld all the way along the edge that I'm pointing to. But if we didn't want that, if we wanted it to stop a little bit short, then say 40 millimeters, then we'd need to actually put a dimension on our weld as well. So in this case, if we were putting this weld on both sides of the plate, we can't see the other side at the moment, we would put a 40 dimension after the weld symbol. So we have the dimension first, the type of the weld symbolized here with the triangle for the fillet weld, and then the length of each of these welds. So this means 8 millimeter fillet weld, 40 millimeters in length. We would assume that it is centered on this part if we're not given any other information, and on both sides of this plate. What would we use to indicate the weld going all the way around the part? So not just being on both sides, but we also weld here and also here on these edges. We have a shorthand for indicating that. It would look something like this. And what that is we can indicate our weld, and then we put a circle on the what we call the knee. This is the knee of our leader arrow here, and that means whatever this weld is, do it all the way around the part and don't stop until it's complete. And in this case, we've chosen to indicate on the other side, but this would be equally valid if we had the 8 in the triangle underneath. So, like this, that would probably be the preferred form. We've got a different type of weld here where we've got these two plates that are joined together by butting them up against each other, and the surfaces of these are aligned in the same plane. That's called a butt weld, and we have a different symbol for that. You can find all the different types of welds and the symbols for them in your engineering drawing handbook. So this type of weld would be indicated something like this, where we have the two vertical lines going down to indicate the two edges of the part that are coming together. And then we point to the intersection where we want this butt weld. We could also indicate it on this drawing like so. Another type of weld that you might come across is a V butt weld, which is where you remove some of the material on both of these parts to make a bit of a V so that you can actually get the weld deeper into that part. And this is particularly useful when the plates that we might be welding together, like these ones here, are quite thick and we can't get the weld to penetrate all the way through in one pass. So how do we indicate that one? That's just got a different type of a symbol. So we have the V symbol now. Again, this is underneath the line here to indicate that the V should occur on the side that we're pointing to. Let's talk about machining and surface texture now, and how we indicate that on our drawings or ask for a particular finish on our parts. In general, we don't request a specific machine or a machining process to be used on our detailed drawings. Usually we ask for the surface finish or the tolerance, and from that we can infer, or the manufacturer can figure out, what is the best tool to use for the job to get that finish and to get that tolerance. And they might have different options available. If we're asking them to make, say, a hole, they might have drills for that, or they might want to punch it, or they might want to flame cut it or plasma cut it, and it's up to them to choose the right manufacturing process to give us the tolerance and the finish that we want. So we usually leave that in their hands. But in a few cases, very rarely, we'll actually need to say what particular process we really want to use to create a particular surface finish. And I'm just going to show you a couple of examples of that. In general, you won't need to do this in your work for this subject and in later years also. So one example that we have here where we may ask for a very particular surface finish is the cylinder block of a car. So this is the cylinder block, and our pistons would go in here and they move up and down, and we have the head which bolts down on top here. And so if you look carefully into this picture, you'll see that there's some very particular crisscross patterns in the bore of our cylinders. And so that is produced by a very special honing process, which is something that we would have to request. And this crisscross pattern of very light kind of spiral scratches on the inside of our bore actually serves a very useful function. It actually holds a film of oil on the sides of the bore, and so this helps prevent it wearing out too quickly. If it's actually polished up really shiny and the oil film can't sit on it easily, then it'll actually wear out quicker. So this is one process, one example of a process we might ask for specifically. Another example is the top of this cylinder here, where it mates with the head. In between the cylinder block and the cylinder head, we usually have a gasket, and that gasket needs to clamp up very tightly and stay put so that it doesn't blow out under the influence of the pressures that are developed inside our cylinder when we get the combustion. And so usually we use a face milling operation, and we intentionally leave this surface here rough with some bigger scratch marks, and this helps key into the head gasket to stop it moving around under those high loading. So these are a couple of examples of where we would ask for very particular surface finishes, but generally we just specify the tolerance and the surface finish, and there are forms for doing that, and then the people manufacturing the part can figure out the best tool for the job. So we have some particular machining symbols that we can use to distinguish between the surfaces that are to be machined and those that must not be machined. So sometimes we want to clearly say machine these ones, but don't machine these ones because they don't need to be machined. We also have some shorthand ways of indicating the required surface texture or roughness that we might want. And we're not really going to go into it in this subject, but if you want to have a look at those, they're covered in Engineering Drawing Handbook in Figure 14.6. So let's look at an example of where we might need to indicate whether a part has been machined or not machined. So here we've got a cross section of a part which has been formed from the casting process. So this is something that we'll learn about later in the manufacturing methods of this course. And basically casting involves taking a molten metal and pouring it into a mold to make the shape that we want. And usually as part of this process, we're required to actually do some machining on this final part as well to bring it up to the required tolerances that we need. So here is a cross section of this part, a bit of an L shape with a hole down the center. And over here is how we would go about drawing it. So I'm gonna take a few machining cuts off this part and then indicate how that would look in the drawing and explain to you the issues that we come across as designers and manufacturers in understanding which bits need to be machined and which bits don't. So say for instance, we're not happy with the tolerance of the casting, which can be quite big, maybe a couple of millimeters. And so we wanted to ensure that this face here on the bottom was flat. So we might take a cut off there with a mill or something like that. And so our drawing would look something like this, where we've got these square edges now, and this is nice and flat rather than the rounded edges that result from the casting and this surface here, which might be a bit bumpy for our liking. As part of the casting process, we can't get nice square corners because generally we cast in sand, and so we can't make a sand mold that is that detailed. And also if we try to make corners, then that can cause the sand to pull out due to the sharp edges on the plug that we use in our part. So we generally try to avoid that when we're designing our sand casting molds. So we've got sharp corners produced, which is good. We might also do a second machining operation so that the distance between these two faces is nice and accurate, and we have another nice flat face up the top here, and we would indicate that on our engineering drawing, our detail drawing as such. And let's say we took a third machining operation here to square up this edge. Perhaps this part needs to butt up against a surface here as well as a surface here, so we want a nice square corner to make that happen. And so our drawing over here would look like this. So you can imagine now the problem comes from, we have this drawing and we can see that there's a radius in here. And usually when you see radiuses like this in corners on an external surface, you think that maybe this part has to be either forged or cast. It's very difficult to machine those corners otherwise. And so we want to be able to communicate to the person manufacturing this, which of these faces we actually require to be machined. One way we can do that is by putting a small tolerance on a dimension. So this dimension between here and here, if we say that it has to be plus or minus 0.2 of a millimeters, that's quite a tight tolerance, something that we'd expect to get to if we're machining the part, but something that's not possible if we just have a casting operation. A casting operation might look more like plus or minus 2 millimeters. So by having 0.2 millimeters there, that kind of implies that these surfaces, these faces, will need to be machined. In some cases, though, we might not have dimensions that would make that implicit, and so we want to indicate, please machine this surface here. And to do that, we use this symbol here, which is like a tick with a triangle kind of closing off the top of it here. And when we represent this symbol, consider this is the same as a number, and so we don't put it on the side. We always want to show it upright, and it sits on the top of this little leader arrow here to indicate the surface that we're referring to. So we might have that arrow there. If we were to put it, let's machine this surface. If we were to put it on the top, we can dispense with the leader arrow altogether, and we can just have it sitting on the surface itself. That indicates exactly the same thing. Another way to do it for faces on the side that we want to machine is to put our arrow just coming out from the side, and again, we sit our little triangle tick box on top of that leader arrow. And the way we indicate not to dimension our surface is by having our tick, but instead of closing it off with a flat top on it, we put a circle sitting inside that tick. So this says to the machinist or the person manufacturing it, you don't need to machine this face here because it's not important to our assembly. A good way to remember it is the one that is square and closed off is the machined one, because we, after flat surfaces, the one that is round with this little circle sitting inside the tick, that's the one where we don't mind if it's a little bit bumpy still. So that says do not machine this surface here. Because this is a do not machine, we don't need to put any additional surface finish annotations on top of this arrow, so we can actually turn this one on the side if we want to, but typically try to keep it vertical if you can. This one, however, needs to stay upright, because sometimes we put numbers and annotations in this space here as part of our standard. This is another surface we want to indicate is not machined. And just for your reference, it's not something that we need to do in this subject. If we do have a very specific surface texture requirement, then these annotations, for instance, N7 is a common one, we would put them above the little closed tick box like so.